From the Library of Congress in Washington, D.C.
Good afternoon. I'm Patrick Anderson. I review fiction for the Washington Post. And everybody at the Post is very proud to be part of this great event and very grateful to you and other people like you who have made it such a success. Today I have the pleasure of introducing one of America's finest writers, finest novelists, Laura Lippman. Laura grew up in Baltimore, the daughter of a distinguished writer for the Baltimore Sun, and later herself became a reporter for the Baltimore Sun. Like a lot of reporters, she decided to try her hand at fiction with great success. Her first Tess Monaghan novel, Baltimore Blues, appeared in 1997, and the 12th in the series, Hush Hush, was published this year. It's a tremendously popular series, but at a certain point, Laura decided to write standalone novels, and they've been equally successful. Her books have won the Agatha, the Anthony, the Edgar, and all the crime fiction prizes. I admire all of Laura's work, but my personal favorite of her books is What the Dead Know. I've reviewed hundreds of crime novels in the past 15 years, and What the Dead Know is one of my all-time favorites, along with Dennis Lehane's Mystic River, Hard Revolution by George Pelicanos, and just a few others. As you may know, Laura is married to David Simon, who also started out as a reporter at the Baltimore Sun and went on to write exceptionally fine television programs, including what many of us consider the best TV drama of all time, The Wire. I tried to think of another American married couple who have exhibited such a level of joint creativity. I had another one. You may be right, but what I came up with was Dashiell Hammett and Lillian Hellman. However, then I remembered that they were never married, so I guess Laura and David are it. It's a pleasure to present Laura Lippman.
Wow. This is really gratifying. I didn't expect. I was coming down here and I checked on Twitter and I read, oh, Walter Mosley has standing room only. And I was like, oh boy, swell. Who's going to want to come to see me? It's my plan to talk for a little bit and then take lots of questions. I like questions because you know better than I do what you actually want me to talk about. So this week on Twitter, and I was thinking that could be the name of a really sad podcast this week on Twitter. I was having an exceptionally silly day, and I just suddenly announced that I wanted to be an advice columnist. I said, all the cool people either have or had advice columns. And I was thinking, of course, of Cheryl Strayed. I was thinking of Amy Dickinson, E. Jane Carroll, and I was just like, I could do this. I could do this. And of course, I was being very silly. I took the name of the advice columnist in a wonderful duo of children's books, Lovey Hart. Ellen Comford was someone I got to meet early in my career, and I kind of just, like, Ellen Comford. I tend to do that when I meet writers. So if you want to do that when you meet me, I'm fine with it. And a couple of people actually asked me sincere questions. And one of the questions someone asked me is, I am going to my first BoucherCon, which is the conference devoted to crime fiction. It's done by volunteers, it moves all over the country. It'll be in Raleigh, North Carolina next month. What should I do at my first BoucherCon? And I said, well, you should never ever say my book. Don't talk about your own book. It seems you think that's why you're there, but it actually is a very ineffectual way to entice people to read you. You just sound like a desperate Fuller Brush salesman going door to door. Well, in my book, and you meet these authors who there is no topic they cannot bring back to my book in like two sentences. I mean, believe me, somewhere out there is an author on a panel right now and they've got their book propped up right in front of them so you can see the cover, and someone could ask them about the crisis in Europe with the immigrants, and they'd say, well, in my book about the bed and breakfast mystery series, this is a very interesting question because the owner is originally from Budapest, and you'd be like, say it. So today, I'm not gonna talk about my book, and if I do, I'm gonna cough when I do it and blurt it out, because I don't need to talk about my book. And I actually have a feeling I don't even need to talk about my genre to people who have decided to take an afternoon to listen to people talk about crime fiction, you know, talk about preaching to the choir. But I'm here today to deliver the news that crime fiction has won. Three of the top four books on the next New York Times bestseller list, crime fiction. But the reason this has been on my mind is this year I've had the incredible privilege and opportunity to serve as a judge for the National Book Awards for fiction. I was knocked out when I was asked. I knew that it would be an incredible challenge to do all the reading I had to do. 450 books were submitted for the National Book Award. And the long list of 10 will be announced, I believe, in about 2 weeks. And I'm really, really, really proud of it. But this has meant not only that I had to do an incredible amount of reading, but that I have not been allowed to speak about what I'm reading to anyone, because I felt that it would give things away. I mean, these proceedings are incredibly confidential, but this is what I can tell you. And this is what I noticed over and over again as I went through the books. So many of the books that are being written now, books that are being promoted for the National Book Award, I would say, you know, one of the top prizes in American fiction, are promoted as, you look at the blurbs, you look at the cover copy. What's it like? It's like blah, 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 literary, blah, 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 and a thriller. Over and over again, I noticed that these very high literary books were being promoted as books that were like thrillers. And I thought a lot about that. I was like, what is the shorthand there? What is the brand that they're trying to transmit? And to me, it means that it's a page turner. You can't wait to find out what happens. You cannot stop reading. You're going to keep going. And I just found it fascinating that this word has now come into the vocabulary of people promoting what would be, you know, considered high-end literary work. So we won. We absolutely won, except we continue to fight. You continue to meet people who say, well, it's Jonathan Franzen had said that he doesn't believe that genre fiction should be reviewed in the New York Times Book Review. He doesn't seem to be aware of the fact that it already is. There's a story, it might be apocryphal, and I should have done my due diligence on this, but it just popped into my head right now, that Franzen's second novel was actually reviewed as a crime novel, and he's never quite gotten over that. I can't speak to that. It was called The 27th City. It was set in St. Louis. In some ways, it was a novel that, in some of its ideas, was way ahead of its time. Why do people, some people, not the people in this room, but I have to imagine that every one of you, if you like crime fiction, and if you don't like crime fiction, if you're looking for the poet who's speaking at this hour, I'll pause for a minute and let you gather your things and... If you were sitting in this room right now and this is the last place you intended to be, don't stick it out. You know, it's okay. My feelings won't be hurt. By the way, if you came here to see me and you're like, oh my gosh, this is awful, you can leave too. That's fine. You know, if it's like, if you thought you were going to get a much different type or higher caliber of talk. But no, I mean, we're in this together. Why did I start writing crime fiction? I started writing crime fiction because I loved it. I've always been someone who read across multiple genres. I'm a big reader. And the thing I noticed about crime fiction is that, and we're talking about when I'm in my 20s, and when I'm in my 20s, I barely have any money. I started at the Waco Tribune Herald in 1981. I made $175 a week, and that was not good money even in 1981. And the great joy of my life was to go to Half Price Books and buy books there. And I moved to San Antonio. I got a raise. I was making $340 a week. And I will tell you, in 1983, when I started making $340 a week, I never really worried about money ever again. That was what I needed. Because what did I need? I needed to be able to put gas in my car, have the occasional night out, pay my rent, and then every Saturday, I would go to this bakery called Twin Sisters in San Antonio, Texas, and I would have what they called, and I'm still so baffled by this, I would have what they called Jewish coffee cake. It was Texas in 1980. And across the street was a bookstore called Bookstop. Doesn't exist anymore, but it was a Texas chain, and I would go across the street and I would buy books. I bought books like they were food, and I bought everything. That was when vintage paperbacks were a new concept, and the idea of publishing someone in paperback without a hardcover, and that's how Jay McInerney appeared with Bright Lights, Big City. It's also how I discovered the work of James Crumley, who became one of my most profound influences, and I might tear up here, I'm happy to say, even became someone I could call a friend. I didn't see him that often or talk to them often, but I did get to know Jim, and I loved him very much and admired him even more, I think. And I bought books so insistently, so ceaselessly, so with so little care of what it was doing to my bank account that a couple years ago I realized I have a lot of really valuable modern first editions. Because when it came to books, it was like that was instant gratification for me. And so I was this huge reader, but I was really aware that there was a certain kind of book that you'd walk around under your arm and you'd get such points just for carrying it around. It was so big and so important. And I've never been the person who, there's something in my nature that doesn't want to play that game. And I noticed that when you were walking around, whether it was with a copy back then of Raymond Chandler or Jim Crumley or pretty soon Carl Hiaasen, Sarah Paretsky, Sue Grafton, whom I discovered through my grandmother's night table, you know, people who didn't read crime novels could be kind of patronizing about it. And you didn't get all that intellectual bonus points for walking around with those books, and that made me want to read them more. And I always remember I had this colleague at the San Antonio newspaper, really smart guy, a really good writer, a better writer than I was at the newspaper. My life is filled with sitting next to guys who were so much smarter than I was and who were such better writers than I was, but who were so darn lazy. They just never wanted to do the work. They wanted the phone to ring and have someone say, "Hi, it's so-and-so at Random House. I want to give you $100,000 for that novel in your head that you've never written one word of." It doesn't exactly work that way. So, but one of these guys, who was a really good writer, really smart guy, said, "Oh, you know who's got a good gig? You know who's got a good gig? That Tony Hillerman, he's got a great gig. You just pick a city that no one's writing about, come up with a detective, write a mystery story, and there you're set for life." I wasn't naive enough to think it worked that way, but it is essentially what I did. I picked my hometown because I loved my hometown, because by now I had moved back to my hometown, and I was wrestling with this dream vision I had of my hometown when I was trying so hard to get back there. And it took me 8 years. It took me 8 years to get a job on a newspaper where my dad already worked. It's not like the saddest story ever. I'm the case for anti-nepotism. But there I was back in Baltimore. It was where I wanted to be, but it was different. You know, it's always different when you get what you want. Always, you know, there's a reason for the old saying, be careful what you wish for. And I was trying to somehow reconcile what I thought life in Baltimore was going to be and what life in Baltimore was like, and which really I was trying to reconcile what a child remembered about life in Baltimore and how an adult experienced life in Baltimore with, you know, it's like I'm taking out the trash. There was, at the time, it's hard to talk about this because I never thought I'd be back in front of an audience saying that the homicide rate in Baltimore is higher today than it was in 1990. I never saw that. I know that this is a trend that's happening nationwide in a lot of cities. No one seems to know why it is. And if you're trying to make a life for yourself in a city where the homicide rate is going up, it's the kind of thing that crime novels are written for. It's one of the ideas that we wrestle with in crime novels. So, as I said, we've won, but what have we won? So many of the top books, television shows, and films are interested in crime. And even some that pretend they're not interested in crime are interested in crime. That's where they start. It's always interesting to me to read a review of a more literary novel that is working in a traditional crime genre vein, whether the writer realizes it or not, and the reviewer decides to award points, if you will, for the fact that the writer is doing all the crime genre stuff really badly. You're like, well, this is a good novel because we don't actually know what happened. Or somebody says, this is a good novel because not all the questions are answered. And you want to say, you haven't read a crime novel, have you? You just haven't. It's okay. But it's like, you know, I have a lot of experience about this, and I hadn't thought to make this comparison until now. It's like watching someone you really love be described in the press, says the woman who is married to, quote, the angriest man in television, end quotes. A 5-year-old headline that's still making the rounds. And it's like, So when I hear outsiders talk about a genre that I'm going to assume everyone in this room loves, I just think, one day you'll get it. And I'm not going to worry about it, because I'm just going to take this line, we won. We won. And if anything, the thing I would like to do is be more inclusive of other genres that are actually finding a harder struggle. Books that are dismissed as so-called chick lit, romance fiction. I went to my first ever romance convention this summer because they gave me an award. And if you give me an award and you tell me beforehand that I have won the award, I will show up. I encourage that kind of behavior. And I was knocked out by how inclusive romance writers are, how diverse and heterogeneous their own genre is, and to me, they get no respect. They get none. And you meet the women and men who are writing romance fiction today, in some cases, couples writing together, which I find even more astonishing. Like, I don't know how anyone, I'm actually working on a project with my husband, so I'll put a pin in that idea. I would just encourage people that these genre labels, if they're keeping you from reading something, they're unhelpful. You know, it's a marketing device, and I'm really sad. I mean, whenever I meet someone who says they don't read crime fiction, I'm always reminded of the Dick Van Dyke Show, where he goes to a party of intellectuals, and he has to keep introducing himself as the head writer of a network variety show, and the woman says, oh, I don't own a television machine. You know, I don't, you know, people say, oh, I'm not interested in beach reads, and my line on that is like, you know what? A book that keeps your interest on the beach is actually a pretty good book. I mean, come on. You know everybody's fallen asleep with War and Peace on their face every summer. It's a good book, but on the beach, and there's the sun, and there's water, and the waves are lapping, that book is not going to keep you awake. So if you want to tell me that what I write is a beach read, I'm going to take that as a compliment. I'm going to say one last thing about my book. The only thing I'm going to say about my book, and it's really not that much about my book. Hush Hush was the 12th novel in the Tess Monaghan series. It was the first novel written after a long break when genius me decided to see what would happen if Tess Monaghan became a mother. And what happened was I couldn't figure out how to write about her. How do you write about a private detective with a three-year-old? How do you honor the genre and its demands for suspense and characters in trouble, and at the same time, make someone a responsible parent? And I thought a lot about that. I teach writing. Sometimes I tell my students when there's something they're desperately trying to avoid because they can sense it's a problem in their text, I said, no, you need to run straight at that thing. So I did what I tell my students to do, and I ran straight at the issue of motherhood, and I wrote a book about Tess Monaghan being a mom. And the book is all about that dreaded term, work-life balance. And what I would ask people in this room today, and I've actually put this out on Twitter a bunch of times as a joke, but yet not. If we're going to talk about work-life balance and people in creative endeavors, it's fine. Ask me about it, but ask my husband about it too. My husband spent 9 months of the last 12 months living apart from his family Monday through Friday in order to make Show Me a Hero. I think that is as relevant to the conversation about what we ask of people to do when they have families as it is to ask me what my childcare situation was, and oh yes, by the way, this book was dedicated to my babysitter. But I really want people to think about it. Either ask everybody or ask no one. You either care about the subject as it affects all people, or you don't care about it at all. So that's the end of my little lecture for today. And I'm coming up on, I thought I'd talk a little bit longer, but I talk fast. So I'm gonna throw this open to y'all, because really, you know better than I do what you want to hear me talk about. So questions, please, or I will just start nattering away. Who knows? I see someone moving toward a microphone. Yay! And there are no wrong questions ever.
This is something I've been curious about for a while. When I start a new author in series, I have to start at the beginning of the series so I don't mess it up. And I noticed that at the beginning of your Tess series, on the back of the book with your picture or inside the cover, whatever, it was this kind of, you know, sideways, kind of sexy, mysterious picture. And then as I got farther in the series, you have like a full-on laughing kind of straightforward portrait, and I wondered if that was anything to do with how you thought of yourself, or if it was a marketing decision, or...
This is a question about author photos. My author photo is currently, it's 9 years old. I happen to think I look better than I did 9 years ago, but okay, so be it. The author photo is a function of marketing, but also sort of where you stand in your publisher's hierarchy. So I would say that until 2003, they were like candids that were shot by friends or family members. And then finally, I think I submitted one that the head of HarperCollins found so dismayingly unflattering that he finally sent me to have a really beautiful author photo that I adored by Marion Ettlinger, who is one of the photographers of authors. And she uses this special technique in the dark room that is immensely flattering to everyone she photographs. I mean, she makes your eyes look... It is... Some of the pictures from this session, there is one that hangs in my office that when I showed it to my husband, he said, it looked like Ilsa the She-Wolf of the SS. I mean, my publisher decided that I looked too mean, and I didn't use that photo, but I used a photo from that session that I loved, but they decided I looked unfriendly and unapproachable, and so then they sent me to a photographer who, by Googling, I was able to establish was clearly someone who shot a lot of middle-aged lady authors. I am what I am, and I went off and I had that photo done in the fall of 2006, and I've had that since. I would like a new author photo, actually, but at the same time, no. It's if I if I chose my author photo, and I attempted to submit this author photo one time, there is a photograph, a black and white, taken, it's now taken almost 15 years ago, so that would be ridiculous, but it's me in a tweed coat that I clearly bought at a rummage sale, laughing my head off. I mean, I'm really like, ah, in front of the old Memorial Stadium before they tore it down. And I would give anything if that would be my author photo. That's how I see myself. So it's an interesting question, though. Thank you very much for letting
Thank you.
Talk about, you know, my public image. You were up next, even though I have gentlemen on that side of the room. I'd like you to ask the next question, because I think you were up there first.
Oh, my God, Laura Lippman.
Woo! Where? Woo!
I discovered you at our local library in Warrenton, Virginia, and I'm really disappointed in losing little bookstores mm-hmm. being taken over by Amazon. Could you speak to that?
Can I speak to independent bookstores, the ones we've lost, the rise of Amazon? So, I'm a writer, and I forget what percentage of the book business Amazon has come to control, but it's a lot. Mm-hmm. So I can't be rude about Amazon, and as a matter of fact, one of my best friends just went to work for them in the book division. Her husband works there as a programmer. That's complicated. So this is what I'll say. It's first of all, I have always put my money in my community. Mm-hmm. That's how I choose to live as a citizen. I give talks for money. I don't give them very often because I want people to pay me a lot of money to talk, and who would really do that? That's ridiculous. But every now and then, some poor, deluded soul comes along and offers me a ton of money to talk, and I do it. I give that money to the Enid Pratt Library. And then I say to people who don't want to give me any money to talk, it's like, well, if it's not part of my book tour, no, because that's the way I raise money for my local library. All of my charitable work is done locally, and I actually attempt to tithe. I actually attempt to give away 10% of my income, and so I shop locally. I try to shop at independent bookstores. I try to shop across. One of the things that I guess the positive way to do it is to use any opportunity like this one here to talk to people about the options they have. And you can get any book you want wherever you live from an independent bookstore if that is a value that you hold dear. I'm not going to tell you to hold that value, but if you live in a community where you no longer have an independent bookstore, it is just as easy to order books from small, I mean, you can order any book you want from Mystery Lover's Bookshop in, you know, outside Pittsburgh. They can order it from the publisher, same as any big retailer. I, you know, worry about consolidation in our culture and our economy. I worry about choice. But the independent bookstores that are surviving are thriving, because I think we have reached this point where, look, I had peers, I won't call them friends, who as recently as 2 years ago were saying that the physical book was dead, and who mocked people who said they liked to read on the page. And like, I don't understand why you would mock anyone's choice of format. But it turns out that there is a diehard audience for real books, and the book isn't going to go away. It's not going to become all digital. I just don't see that happening. And so it's like, so educate yourself. What are your values? Shop your values. And I mourn every independent bookstore we've lost. If I'm really honest, I've known some independent bookstores that went under and I wasn't surprised. They were not run very well. I would never name names, but I traveled a lot over the years, went to a lot of independent mystery bookstores. You could tell which ones knew what they were doing and which one was like, someone's like, woo, it'd be so much fun to have a bookstore. Inventory, what's inventory? What do you mean that that book I'm selling that has a title like yours is actually written by Dave Barry? Oops, is that a problem? No, that actually happened to me. So, I mean, I don't know, is that a satisfying answer? I mean, shop your values, live by your values, whatever they are. I mean, you know, there are people who tell me, look, I live in the middle of nowhere, Amazon was there for me when no one else was. And so, I'm not gonna tell people how to live, only that the way they live should reflect what they think is important. And if you think having diverse stores and therefore diverse books is important, then you gotta shop that way.
Thank you so much.
Thank you. Yes, sir.
Yes, could you speak a little bit about and tell us what your writing process is?
My writing process? I write a book a year. And it's pretty much, I've tried to go faster. I can't go that much faster. I also can't go that much more slowly. And I become immensely frustrated at the idea that being speedy somehow makes me lesser. There are a couple of writers, I'm not gonna name names, boy would I like to. They go a long time between books. They go a long time between books. And then the book comes out and people are like, oh, after 10 years, so-and-so has written their first book. And I'm like, dude, check out IMDb. I'll tell you what that guy's been writing for the last 10 years. He's been writing screenplays and TV shows. He wasn't working on the book every precious minute of the last 10 years. I'm a fast writer, and it's weird to me that being a fast writer is seen as being some sort of detriment. I can't imagine that in sports circles, the marathoners sit around and make fun of the 100-yard dash people. Like, she's no good, she runs that race really fast. You know, if she was good, she'd run 26.2 miles like me and take, you know, anyway. My process is I come up with an idea. The idea is often influenced by real events, but I'm never interested in the big stories. I'm much more interested in not well-known stories, particularly things that happened in my youth in what I call the pre-CNN era, when crime kind of stayed local and not, like, you know, Patrick mentioned What the Dead Know. When the Lyon sisters disappeared in the mid-1970s, people in, you know, maybe from Northern Virginia to Baltimore knew the story, and that's it, you know? And now, more and more people, I mean, it's, you know, again, there's this hunger for crime stories, and I seem to get a lot louder all of a sudden. So, get the idea, and I start to write. I used to try to get through the entire first draft without stopping. And now I work more like I'm running a series. God, all these track analogies, you'd think I was actually athletic. It's like wind sprints. I go as far as I can, I get stuck, I return to the beginning, I start rewriting, I get a little further, back to the beginning, get a little further, back to the beginning. And in that way, I develop what I call my first draft, but a third of it will be in solid third draft form. You know, more will be in second or third draft form. And then sort of the last 50 pages are a revised first draft. That goes off to my editor and agent, comes back, another revision. I mean, I would say that by the time I'm finished, I've actually revised a book 5 to 6 times. And that's what I do. I don't romanticize it. Having ideas is my job. And I feel lucky that I ended up in a job like that. I'm totally anti-muse. Like, I don't have the luxury to sit around and wait. No, I get up in the morning, I go to work, like most of the people in this room. Doesn't seem like a lot to expect. And I keep all of my draft files because the day comes, and it always comes, like, I'm stuck, it's awful, this is terrible, I'm not gonna finish. And I'll say, okay, where were you on this day a year ago? And I go open up my files, and I always find that I was just as stuck and just as despairing, and that the book a year ago at that time was going just as badly. Does that cover everything? Is there something more? Okay.
Thank you very much.
And I research on a need-to-know basis. I research just enough. I don't want to get lost in research. I think that becomes a really clever way to procrastinate.
Thank you.
You, sir.
Hello. So you've, I imagine you've gone to many book conventions. You said you're a teacher. What do you think that the next generation of readers is looking for in your crime novels? And is it significantly different than perhaps an older generation was?
What are y'all looking for? Please tell me. We talk about this a lot. Because the good news is that young people are reading, and they're reading a lot. And they're reading with passion. And what's that new genre they call? There's a new genre that's not young adult, but it's just beyond. What's it called? New adult? Anyway, people are just reading more and more. I think that young people want to see their world reflected in crime novels. And I think that's part of the reason that you have rising stars like Megan Abbott. If you haven't read Dare Me and The Fever, you're really missing out. And I think that's why most of us read. We want to explore new worlds, worlds that are completely outside our experience, but at the same time, we also want to see our own experiences or our own ideas about human nature reflected back to us. Really, but seriously, everyone I know wants to know what young people want in crime fiction, and I haven't heard a good answer. When I'm asked about my own books, I always like, oh, go read To the Power of Three. It's about three teenage girls and a shooting. But I don't really know. My kid is only 5, so in 10 years I'll be using her to focus group this relentlessly.
Thank you so much.
Thank you. Over here.
Hello. So I do have a question, but I also want to mention that all the book sales here, as far as I know, are through an independent local bookstore, Politics and Prose. So yay, that. My question has to do with the difference between the series you write and the independent books that you write. And so which do you, how do you know which book you're going to write that year, and which do you prefer?
So series versus standalones. I won't say I have a preference. They have different charms. I've written over 1 million words about Tess Monaghan, and I have probably spent more time with her than I have with any other flesh and blood human, maybe outside my husband and now my kid. So there is the joy of returning to her, of knowing her so well. She feels like my young sister. I just get her. And you would think that should be obvious. You made her up. But Tess Monaghan was, I didn't know I was doing this when I did it, but it was almost as if I created an imaginary friend for myself in my adulthood, and she is the most satisfactory imaginary friend I could have imagined. I really love hanging out with Tess. And I like her for the ways in which she's different from me, that she's much more impulsive. But in the end, she has a fairly positive, sort of like a ruefully positive view on human nature. My standalones are really dark, and they don't necessarily deliver uplifting or redemptive endings. And they're tough to write. They take a lot out of me. And I'm sometimes sad because they're characters I encounter in my standalones that I would like to spend more time with. Certainly Bambi and After I'm Gone, the book that came out in 2014, that whole family, I would love to hang out with that family, but they're gone. There's nothing more to say about them. Their story is over. I think I feel a little bit more confident when I start writing a test book that I can do this, I know how to do this, but then there's the problem of how do I make it fresh? I don't ever want to write the same book twice. And there are some series in American crime fiction, some great series in American crime fiction where there was some repetition. So I don't know if I would say that. It's become very complementary, and it's the idea that drives what it's going to be. And that started by accident when I came up with the idea for the book Every Secret Thing, which was published in 2003. And I wanted to write a book about two girls who had done something at a very young age and were now released from juvenile justice facilities and trying to start over. I'm like, that's not a Tess Monaghan book. That would never be a Tess Monaghan story. It's their story. And so it started by accident, just like I can't make this a Tess book. And then I really felt that writing the standalones became very complementary to the Tess series, and that the Tess books got better, and that's my hope. I'm trying to get better with every book. People have said to me over the years, I hope you don't mind if I say to you that you did get a lot better. And I said, well, you know, no, because what are the alternatives? I stayed exactly the same. I'm amazingly up and down, or I got a lot worse. I'm like, I'll take I got better. So thank you. Over there.
I need to preface this by saying that it doesn't apply to your books. But I read a lot of books and I finish and say, man, that book needed an editor. Did they even have one? And so I'm interested in the relationship between writers and editors and would love to hear you comment on it. But also to say that one of my theories is people whose training is in journalism bring a lot of that editing skill already to their writing.
I can't speak to anyone else's writer-editor experience. I know that, I will say I think that most writers get the editing they deserve because there are people who fight editing so hard that in the end they're gonna win and it's not to their benefit. I've had the same editor for all of my books, which is an increasingly unusual thing to be able to say when you're 20 plus books into a career. And the one thing I know for certain is that if my editor has a concern, I need to think about it. I don't have to necessarily address it in the way she, but if she's flagging something, I gotta look at it. I'll tell one inside baseball story here. So I wrote a book called After I'm Gone, where there was a retired cop named Sandy who was looking into, a long ago case. You know, he was actually retired. And he joins up with Tess Monaghan at the end of that book, and then he's in the next book, Hush Hush. And I turned in Hush Hush, and my editor and someone else who read the early pages said, why doesn't Sandy have a chapter where we see things from his point of view? And I said, because he's in every scene with Tess, and I just have this rule that if Tess is in the scene, Tess has POV. And you know, like, it's a made-up rule, obviously, I don't, you know, but... So she flagged it, and it was like, okay, I gotta think about this. If Carrie is saying that she misses Sandy, that's legit. Now, what I did was I created three scenes for Sandy that Tess wasn't there. And one of them turned out to be one of my favorite scenes in the book. So I take editing, and I listen very hard, and I do try to be hard on myself. People, I think secure writers take editing. And I'm confident enough to take a hard edit. I always joke that my editor's primary function is to take out, I feel like in every book I write, I have this lengthy paragraph about how the Washington Wizards used to be the Washington Bullets, and they used to be the Baltimore Bullets. And I feel like that's been cut out of every book I've ever written. I might have finally gotten it in. I clearly, standing behind Wes Unsel in the corner grocery store had a profound impact on me when I was 8 years old. Next question. I've only got 2 minutes left, so I'm going to try to get to the last three questions. Try to be fast.
This can be pretty quick, but I read and loved the book about the Lyons sisters, and when it came out again in the papers, recently, it devastated me. And I wondered what it was like for you.
You know, when it comes to the Lyons sisters, and there are people who don't like the fact that I used a real life case as inspiration, mm-hmm. and they find that not a defensible choice. And that's a long, long answer that I won't go into. You know, I can't speak for what the family wants, but I think that answers are better than no answers, and you hope, mm-hmm. and you just hope that there'll be answers one day. It's a terrible thing to live, but the answers aren't going to be...
No, they were horrible.
There's one novel, I'm not going to name names, I just don't do that to people. There's a very popular novel some years ago that put forward a pretty devastating scenario and then had it have the most impossible, super cozy, nobody has to feel bad, nothing bad happened to the missing kid ending. I thought that was reprehensible. I was just like, that's what gets me mad, It's like, you know, if you're going to write about crime, be honest about what crime is like, and be honest about what it's like for the victims. And I really, I'll go back, I'm going to end here since I know I'm out of time. So I was a reporter for a long time, and I felt that when we deal with real events, we're seeking to disengage. When terrible things happen in our neighborhood, our city, our country, wherever, we want to read about that and figure out why it's not going to happen to us. And that is normal and human, and it's actually probably a sane response to a horrible crime. But it doesn't help us develop empathy for victims. So I really do believe that in writing crime fiction, where the reader's guard is down, the reader is leaning in, if you will, and is feeling it, and is not feeling threatened by it because it's not a true story, it opens up a path to empathy for people who have been affected by crime. And, you know, if I have a little mission, something I'm trying to do, I really want people to think about that. And the last thing I'll say, and I know I'm out of time, I took my daughter and one of her best friends, who's a little bit older, who's 8, to the Museum of Natural History this summer. And the 8-year-old was appalled that there were animals that had been shot and stuffed and put on display for our amusement. She's like, how could that happen? And I said to her, Mia, if you live long enough, if you live a normal lifetime, something that is perfectly acceptable today will be unthinkable by the time you're 80. And that's what I think about every day that I'm writing. Thank you.
This has been a presentation of the Library of Congress. Visit us at loc.gov.